Hey everyone, I'm excited to introduce to you Lily Yoon, who is a director of sales at TeleVet. And I think, so we met through Linda Lin's Society of Asians in Sales and Customer Success. Really cool community, met some really cool folks through it, and the programming has been amazing. But excited to have you on the podcast, and this is episode 99.
Awesome. Thanks so much for the introduction. Really excited to be here. Happy to provide any insights and excited about the conversation.
Yeah, I'm curious because I don't see too many managerial Asians, specifically in client-facing roles, like in tech or at a lot of startups. Usually when I do see them, sometimes they're more in finance positions or product or, you know, software engineering roles. I'm curious, like, what's something that you think is bogus that a lot of people think that about, like, a managerial role, like being in a managerial position?
Oh, yeah. I have to say, I even had this thought too, but it was definitely different once I got into a managerial position. It was the idea of it's all about just motivating, growing people. So all the positives, and those are definitely there. But then there's also the backside of it of like, there's a lot of different aspects of getting people to grow. You know, you have to hold people accountable. You have to have difficult conversations with people. And, once, you know, you start getting into that role and you have a good idea of communication with that person on your team, it gets a bit easier over time because you're understanding each other's expectations of each other. And so I think the overall idea of like management is all about leadership and it's all about helping people grow and not understanding the work that it takes to get there is a lot of the things that people realize once they get into a management position.
Interesting. I'm sure you have a lot of top performers who have the results, but maybe tend to have that lone wolf mentality, or maybe they're not like as willing to share their tips for success, right? How do you deal with someone who maybe is producing results, but could be a little bit better about contributing to the team or the company as a whole?
Yeah, that's a good question. I've had several lone wolves on the team before, and yeah, you know, they are really great leaders in a sense too, because they have their own process that they find that works that helps them become a great leader. I think it's just having the communication with them of you are doing something great. You're hitting your numbers. Yeah. You may not be following our processes that we have set in place that are helping other people grow too, but how can we find a medium together to help share your knowledge with the rest of the team? So that way they can also be, you know, very successful too. And so usually when people, you know, have that type of skill set, they're more than willing to help the rest of their team. And, you know, sometimes some people are like, hey, I just want to do what I do want to do. Like, I just want to focus on my number, and that's okay too. But still trying to find a ways to get them to be a part of the team is really important.
What's your thought on, cause I think having process obviously is better for scalability, predicting revenue and things like that. But what if, I guess, like, because some people, I guess, what are your thoughts on sales being an art and a science? Like, do you see it like a 50-50 split, or is every individual different? Like, what's your thoughts on that?
Yeah, I don't know if there's a specific ratio. Usually from what I see, It's a mixture, right? Like the fact of like a process having numbers, you know, sales is all a numbers game. Like the more cold calls, emails you send, the more likely you'll be able to connect, do a demo, close a deal. So that type of thing is all about process. And so I believe that anybody can follow a process once it's built out. And it just is that their will to follow through and continue doing that. Which everybody can. I think the other thing is to your point of like, it's somewhat an art as well, because each conversation, each prospect you're talking to, their needs and pains are all different. And so you have to kind of mold yourself to be like putty so you can make yourself a little bit more adaptable to that specific person you're talking to. So I think, for example, like, yeah, I have generally like a slower pace in speaking. And, you know, one of the feedbacks that my manager always told me was like, hey, if you're speaking to a New Yorker, you got to pick up your pace, get straight to the point, or they're going to hang up on you. And so, yeah, you know, just things like that. I think it is type of a skill and art that can be formed over time as you have more and more conversations.
I mean, and on that note, like, how do you trust yourself and build your own process and do and double down on what you're good at versus like actually being adaptive? Because I think earlier in my career, I was too adaptive, where every feedback I would try to implement like immediately versus just finding my own voice and just really just knowing and having the intuition and the confidence that like, hey, I'm providing value.
Yeah. And I think that's good. That's a really good mindset of like, I'm open to trying different things that have been told to me as feedback. I think the one extra layer to add in is really understanding, are there any type of metrics to back up why you should be implementing something? So, you know, I know a lot of team members will say like, hey, this has been working, try this, you know, taking a step further and be like, hey, could you like pull like your call records or like any type of data around like how many dials you make, how many you actually converted into appointments. So, and then from there you have your data set of understanding like, okay, this type of feedback resulted this type of results for this person. Let me prioritize what I should try first, because understanding what you're needing to improve on first is really important. And that's where it's helpful to have a manager who is also data driven too, because, you know, they'll be able to show you, you know, your connect rates are really low. Let's figure out, you know, how we can improve your connect rates, whether it's better prospecting, calling at different times of the hour. And then you can prioritize the feedback your colleagues have given you of like, okay, my connect rate's low. Let me see if I've gotten any feedback from colleagues around how they've improved their connect rates, and then get an idea of like percentage increases they've seen. And so I've always been a believer of like, you can't just do it for a week and say, hey, this isn't working for me and move on to something else. You have to do it for at least, you know, maybe a month minimum to really understand like, okay, I've got enough of a sample data for me to say this is actually working or this isn't actually working. I need to transition to something else.
Yeah, that kind of reminds me of Tim Ferriss always suggests, and I've been doing this more recently, but at the end of every week, just reflect, look at your calendar the whole week and see what were the most productive activities. Because I think sometimes we think we know what it is, and then you have and then we all have awareness around like, okay, what didn't really yield, didn't move the needle forward, and what ultimately yielded what he calls like 10x returns, right? Mm-hmm. So that practice has helped me just have a lot more awareness around like, okay, like this is nice and this is fun, but you know, maybe limit that to like once or twice a week, right?
Yeah, definitely.
So it sounds like you are like data driven, and I think obviously being a manager, like, you know, it like it's good to like, how do you create like brand new KPIs, right? Because I know this job, it's a relatively new role that you're in, and you know, you're kind of building everything from scratch. Like, how do you, like, how often do you, you know, evolve your or change your KPIs, and how do you even know like what to look for? Because I think technology and things are always changing so quickly.
Yeah, that's a good question. So I had the opportunity to really start the sales team from the ground up. So I was the first sales hire, and I got to hire my team members after my first month there. And with that, like, it was an exciting time to just be able to really, well, first understand the industry that I'm selling to and creating like ideal customer profile. And then understanding like how they best communicate. Is it via email, phone calls, you know, what's going to yield the highest results? And that all starts with having the right platforms or the tools to get that type of information. And so, you know, I tested a lot of different CRMs and then also some sales enablement platforms as well to see which ones can really help the team get the data that we need to help build our KPIs. And so that was a part of the hiring process too. It was just like letting the team, letting these people know, like, reality wise, like, we're going to be building this together.
Yeah.
Which is exciting for a lot of people. And sometimes for some people, that's not exciting. They like stability, which is okay. And so, you know, I was very fortunate where I found team members who were like, yes, let's build this together. You know, and it was really just leveraging my previous experiences and knowledge of, hey, like, let's try for at least 60 dials every day, see what our connect rates are this month, compare it to next month. Let's try different times of days to call. And then we started just building and comparing our numbers month over month. And we'll do like something called a retrospective at the beginning of every month to recap on the previous month's activities. What type of campaigns did we do? What type of activity messaging did we use? And what type of response rates were they getting? Template one, you know, doing a lot of A/B testing for emails, messaging. Template one got a high open rate, but it had a lower reply rate than template two. Like, what messaging do we need to change up for this week? So really just being comfortable with the first month or two of testing things out and not knowing what's actually going to work. And then taking that data to be like, okay, we have a baseline now. Let's improve this.
And on that note, because it seems like you have helped a lot of people get SDs or BDRs get promoted, like, how do you keep someone like even keeled or consistent over the years? Because, you know, like with any position, but especially in a BDR / SDR role, I think just having consistency over time is like the key to success. So how do you keep someone motivated when maybe, especially in the middle of a like right now, right? We're still in the pandemic. Like, how do you keep someone like still engaged, especially as, you know, everything ultimately is becoming more virtual too. So it's even harder to really like see how they truly are at the moment.
Yeah. It is very challenging being virtual and trying to sell and train people on selling as well through Zoom. I think the helpful thing has been just having that conversation with the team of like, I'm available whenever you need me. Don't hesitate to reach out. Even if like my calendar looks like I'm packed, like I keep my calendar open so that everyone can see what meetings I'm going in. And I'm just like, just message me. I give them my cell phone number, tell them to call me if they need anything. So opening up the communication line to know, you know, they can reach me at any point in time. But then also doing check-ins throughout the day has been helpful. Usually when you're on the sales floor, like you can hear each other talk and you can check in, join conversations. But I usually do like a midday check-in via Slack and I'll just be like, hey, like how's things going? Do you need help with anything? Or I'll just hop on a quick call with them. Another great thing is transitioning my stand-ups to be more conversational in the beginning. Mm-hmm. So asking how people are doing, like if they did anything fun over the weekend, or coming up with games ideas for the week or challenges, trying to bring the team together because we're all separate and we're all virtual, and at least keeping each other up to date on competition points. And you know, that it kind of brings out like that friendly competitiveness as well virtually. So it gets the team talking, which is what I want. I want them to still feel like they're in a team environment, even though they're all working from home.
Yeah. And you've gone through a lot of hiring as well. Like, what are some of the qualities that you look for? And maybe has that even shifted over time as, you know, you've had even more management experience now?
Yeah, I think it really depends on the role requirements, like whatever role you're hiring for, you have to adjust your what you're looking for, because it's not just about finding someone that who has experience, but it's also about like, will this person thrive in this organization? And so it really is like, do they meet the requirements of the role itself? But then do they have the passion? Are they behind the mission of the company? Because depending on the role or depending on the company itself, like, as you know, SDR role is really hard. Like you're calling nonstop. With AEs, it's a little different. They're calling too, but then they actually get to close the deals too. Where on the SDR side, you're calling to set up for someone else to close. And that's why so many SDRs want to become AEs, which is great. But I think that's the thing with SDRs in general, you face so much rejection that sometimes you have to have that mentality of like, there's an overall mission. There's a goal for myself, whether it be career-wise or helping the company grow and go from like a small startup to, you know, bigger company, to keep them pushing through those hard days.
So like, cause I hear from a lot of SDRs that, and I always give them this advice, but like, make sure you pick a company whose product you truly can stand for, like that you're actually really passionate about. But I hear from a lot of like first time SDRs or people who want to do that, say like, well, I'm not sure what I'm really passionate about. Like, I don't know, like, at least when it comes to technology, like there's nothing that really like, oh my God, I'm excited to call this type of, you know, company, this type of industry. So I always hear that when I speak with like hundreds of SDRs over the course of my lifetime.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So what advice would you give to someone who's like, they know they want to do tech, they know they want to be an SDR because they hear that, oh, it's good money and it's good for my career and I develop good skills, but they're like, well, there's so much tech out there. I don't even know where to start.
Yeah, I've actually had someone reach out to me for some guidance, actually, because they came from a different background of experience, no tech sales, anything like that. And so literally that was like the question they asked me, like, I don't know where to start. And I was like, all right, you know, first thing is understanding, is tech sales, what is tech sales? Like, is it an inside sales role that you're looking for? What is your experience like? Are you okay with rejection? And you know, once you check off those boxes, it's more so like, what are your interests? Like, there's so many different tech companies out there now in specific industries, like TeleVet's a veterinary communication software. There's so many other companies that are like maybe fitness focused now. And luckily this person is from like a fitness background. And so I was like, hey, you know, that's an interest to you. Then why don't you look at some of the fitness companies out there that are focused on tech? And so, you know, kind of routed her that direction and she started looking up tech companies. And there's a lot of great resources online for companies that are hiring entry-level sales roles. And so looking at those websites, roles, and applying to the ones that really stand out to you first will be important, because if you already have a connection, it just makes it less like a job, but more like a mission that you're on to help drive the benefits of that company to the clientele.
Yeah, that's really good advice. That's one thing that I wish like I knew like going into tech, right? Because I would just kind of just take whatever tech job paid the most money at the time early in my career. And I never really like actually took the time to sit down and like think like truly like, hey, like what do I like? You know, what am I passionate about? And then find a company that I think I was just like, well, this company has the highest base, so I'm going to go with that. You know, I think that's common amongst like a lot of first time SDRs.
Yeah. I mean, that is definitely common. And that was the case for me too. When I first started, I was like, oh, cool. Like, this will get me out of Dallas. I'll be in Austin where I like being living and pay is good. And I think I really learned from like, I think it's just a learning experience. Like, you learn like, hey, like this job was really hard for me at certain points. And, you know, let me look for a company where I can actually see a vision of myself being motivated and help the company grow that way.
Yeah. I mean, it sounds like you're pretty self-motivated. I'm not sure if it comes from like your parents or, cause I also meet a lot of people who, I have two separate questions actually. So one question is like, what's something about tech sales that people like don't know that they should know? Cause I think a lot of people look at like, you know, they look at the salaries and they're like, oh my God, this is awesome. Right. But they don't like, I don't think a lot of people realize like, hey, it's like, it's harder than you think in some instances.
Yeah, I guess in the sense of like full cycle sales, A lot of people don't realize that they still need to outbound for themselves too.
Yeah.
I feel like a lot of people who want to go into full cycle sales is because they really do enjoy closing deals and having conversations and, you know, finding solutions for prospects. And I think that the pipeline generation prospecting aspect is kind of like on the back burner because, you know, bottom of the funnel type of activities like closing deals is definitely more one of the most important things. But at the same time, like you still have to maintain prospecting. And so I think a lot of people go into wanting to do full cycle without realizing you're still inherently an SDR at heart. And so that's why it's really great to see SDRs, like people start in the SDR role, go into a full cycle sales role because they're like, I already know how to do this. Like, you know, I can continue prospecting and now I'm going to start learning how to close deals.
Yes, that's good advice. I would say all the best AEs or results wise, like all the ones that perform the best do come from like an SDR role and not like a 3 month SDR role, but like, you know, have had at least some time in it, right? Where you truly get to master that role. I think luckily I was in SDR for like 3-4 years, so it's helped me a lot. But yeah, it's funny because like you said, like there's a lot of like full cycle salespeople who like haven't had like any SDR experience or not enough. And they tend to definitely like struggle as like, at least at LinkedIn, for instance, like now I don't get any inbounds. Whereas before I used to get inbounds, right? So that was like 50% of our pipeline. So it's changed a lot. So, I mean, I'm doing fine, right? Cause I've had like 4 years of SDR experience, but a lot of people are struggling with that transition. And it's something that I think most people assume that you don't have to make like that, you know, any prospecting or outbounds anymore. But I think nowadays, I think most positions that you still have to make some, at least the best, like the top performing AEs will definitely do a lot of outbounding.
Yeah. Definitely. Yeah.
Yeah. And I'm curious, like, why you chose to go into the management route. Obviously, people who become managers, like, don't always do it for the money, right? They do it because, like, other reasons. What made you know for sure that you wanted to pursue a career in the managerial track versus, like, potentially just making a boatload of money, just being a really good intentional individual contributor?
Yeah, that's a good question. I actually had this conversation with my husband a few years ago. and this is because like, I was in a team lead position at that time, at that company. And there's a few other team leads and we all wanted to go into management. And so we were working really hard to get the experience. So that'd be when the management position opened up, we can apply and it'd be a pretty easy transition. And the first time the role opened up, I interviewed and I didn't get the role. I had a really tough time accepting, trying to understand why. And my husband at that time was just like, why do you want to become a manager so bad? Like, do you know why other than like being a type of career progression? And for me, it was because taking a step back, like having that experience as a team lead gave me the opportunity to really help people grow into a role. And I initially didn't even know what to expect when I got into a team lead role. I was like, all right, I'm just gonna help people, like teach people how to do certain things on Salesforce and, you know, send out emails and objection handle. And then it became so much more than that because it became a thing of, I'm helping this person grow, but at the same time, I'm growing too. I'm finding ways of communicating differently than I normally would because each person learns at a different pace in different ways. And so I found the enjoyment of not just helping other people, but like understanding how to communicate better with other people on the team. And so I think that's what really helped me understand, like, no, I do want to go into management, not just because that's another step in a different career track for me, but it's because there is so much more of a mission because I have knowledge and I have the ability to help people, but then also grow in that role myself. So that's the reason why I went into management. And Interestingly enough, I have been in management for about 4 years now, and it still is, you know, it still is different every single day. Like, you think over time you would have like management down to a pact of like, oh yeah, like this is like the back of my hand, but it's always a different challenge, always learning something new, because you know, your job is to help people grow and help generate revenue at the same time. So every day is a little different.
I have a couple questions in regards to that, actually. So, I mean, I hear, like, people always say, like, oh, you don't make that much as a manager. Like, one, is that necessarily true? I know every company is different, but it can't be as bad as, like, what managers always tell me. They're like, no, like, we really don't make that much money. So that's the first question, and I'll ask you the second question after that.
Yeah. I mean, just to be honest, like some individual contributors definitely, like full cycle sales reps definitely make more money than managers do. And it's because like the roles are different, you know, the requirements are a little different. Responsibilities are different too. Like, you have an enterprise sales rep who closes maybe a 200,000 deal. It's like, yeah, they put a lot of effort in there. The manager was helping that rep through certain things, but the person who really brought the deal across is that sales rep. So they should get compensated for that. So I think that's fair if the sales rep is getting paid more than the manager at times. At the same time, I think that's why it's important that compensation structure is built out to be matching that type of structure itself. So, you know, my team's success is my success. So in a sense, like, whatever, like they usually have team quotas, right? So whatever cumulative team quota, it makes up my compensation. And that drives me to really just focus on helping my rep be successful instead of me trying to just like take over all the deals and try to close deals myself.
I'm curious, like, cause you've had a lot of employees, like one of the hardest things must be like when it's not a good fit ultimately, right? I guess like if I ever do become a manager, I think that would be the hardest thing for me. How do you go about like having that conversation, and how do you know, and have you had instances where you're like, I don't know if this is necessarily going to work out, but then somehow they changed and they did like a 180 and they ended up being like a really good rep and even have gotten promoted since then.
Yeah. Having those difficult conversations is never easy. No matter how many times you do them, because everybody is a human being. We all have feelings. And I think at the end of the day, though, it's like we have to be okay with the fact that, you know, we're going to have these conversations if things aren't working out. And my rule of thumb is it should never come as a surprise to that person. Like, you should have multiple conversations. And, you know, start off with like, hey, and this is why probably data management is really important too, like noticing trends, whether it be on the activity side, but then also like, I guess, emotionally as well. And just like as a manager, picking up on that really quickly and not just letting it mull over for a while, because then that can build up over time. So usually like you do weekly, you know, activity check-ins, and, you know, after 2 weeks, you're like, hey, like I'm noticing your activities are kind of like low, or this week your activities are low. Like, is anything going on? And since we're all human, it's like most of the cases it's been like personal related, you know, like, hey, like, you know, it's been really tough at home, X, Y, and Z. Like I haven't had a chance. And those type of conversations, it's like understanding where that person's coming from. And then it's my job as a manager to be like, okay, how do we make this work then? Because you're having a hard time with this personally. Let's try to make work less stressful for you during this period. And so instead of it coming from a top-down approach of like, you didn't hit your activities, you need to be hitting more activities next week to make up for this. Like, no one's going to really reciprocate like positively to that situation. Yeah. And so usually just having that initial conversation to understand why there's a difference in activity or in attitude is initial step. And then helping them figure out a way to get past that is important. But at the same time, it's like, you know, they have to meet you halfway. Like you're meeting them halfway. They need to just kind of meet you there that way too. And then if you're still noticing the same behaviors, that's when you have to have more of the serious conversations of like, hey, we talked about this 2 weeks ago and I'm still noticing this. Like we need to figure out a better way of addressing this situation. And that's why after that, you know, performance improvement plans are, you know, they sound really scary. But usually it's to just make sure like everybody's on the same page. Cause you know, no one wants to be told after like one day of like being told, hey, you need to improve this. And the next day be told like, hey, you're not, you know, part of this company anymore for whatever reason. Mm-hmm. So a lot of people are scared of performance improvement plans, but in reality, it's actually a good way to like take it as a reality check personally and be like, okay, this is an opportunity for me. I'm being told like I need to fix things. And it's up to that person to be like, okay, I definitely want to fix things and make a difference, or they can take it the other route and be like, look, this isn't really for me. So, you know, they choose to opt out.
That's and kind of on a similar note, like what are your thoughts and philosophy on like an empowering comp plan? Like I'm sure you've been part of building like SDR comp plans and things like that a lot of times.
Yeah. You know, comp plans are really interesting. They can evolve over time for sure, based off of what you're noticing. I've probably gone through over 10 comp plans while I was at one company. And that's also because of like promotions and stuff like that too. But in the same role, like there are changes that were made, and that makes sense because if your company is growing, and it depends on what type of company you're at, but let's say you're like early stage startup and you're noticing your initial comp plan was on demo sets, but you know, you're noticing a high like no-show rate. Let's say your no-show rate is like 50%, then your reps are probably going to compensate on just demo sets, but not on demos actually happening, which is what's helpful for the AEs in your company. So you probably need to reevaluate, okay, we need to fix our no-show rate. So let's change compensation and be on demos occurred for the SDRs. And so it can vary over time. And I think it should be done with the SDRs in mind of like, how do we make sure though that they're still motivated to hit these goals? And, you know, I think it's two parts, like helping them understand why the change is happening and how it's going to be helpful to grow the company, even though it is a change for them, and how it's going to be beneficial to everybody long-term. But also putting in anything like accelerators, like, you know, motivate people to do more than just hitting 100%, because 100% is awesome, but it's like, you know, you and I have both done it where we're like, oh, we hit 100%. Okay. you know, but it's like also the fact of team mentality of like, just because you hit 100%, you know, your teammate may be like one or two deals away from hitting 100%. So don't just stop making dials, like still help make dials, like, you know, help that team member who's trying to fight for that one last opportunity, like motivate them by joining them on making dials and stuff like that. So I think with compensation plans, it can change, but there's definitely ways to motivate, not just like with money, but also the overall goal of how changing that compensation plan can help them.
Yeah. And I think this is a similar question, but like, what are your thoughts on more of like a collaborative? Because I think my opinion is a lot of comp plans tend to promote like more individual like performance versus like contributing to the team in general. And obviously there needs to be that laser focus, like heads down mentality, right? To be like a good IC. But once you've kind of gotten past that stage and you're consistently performing, but then how do you also incentivize them that they're still contributing to the overall like company, not just like their own paycheck?
Yeah, this is so much easier when we're all in the office, but we used to have like a huge whiteboard, and then you'd have the overall team goal as like a funnel, and then we would just like fill it in and try to like get to where like where 100% of that funnel is filled up as a motivator. And so, you know, I'm sure you can do that virtually somehow. I'm sure there's like a program out there that you can do that. But Yeah, just kind of helping them understand that it's not just like your number, it's also a team number. And I think the moment it really clicked for me was because I was much more of like, I just need to hit my number. And if I ever attain, that's great. I'm going to keep pushing because there's always a quota next month as well. But I think the really, it really clicked for me on the team side of it was when the team members were all working really hard closing week to get to their number as quickly as they could. And, you know, my manager at that time was just like, hey, like, we're so close. Like, if we hit this goal, you know, that'll help us generate this much more revenue on the sales side with potential to close. And, you know, that can get us to this, like, you know, ARR goal as a company that we've never hit before. And so that conversation of him expressing how our work at the top of the funnel can hugely impact the end of that month for us as a company of hitting this ARR goal really just clicked with me and was like, okay, I want to pick up the phone. I want to make more dials. Let's see what we can bring in this week. And I think it was the same for everybody else. Like we didn't really know. And I think that's one thing to always keep in mind is just like, especially with maybe SDRs who are, this is their first job.
Yeah.
They don't really know the full ins and outs of like a company and business running together. And it can be somewhat siloed of like, my job is my job. This is what I need to do. Yeah. And this is the number I need to hit without really understanding like how that actually impacts the entire organization.
Yeah.
And it's a huge impact that they make too.
So it sounds like my takeaway from that is companies need to do a good job of really filling in like what the SDRs are doing, how it ultimately like contributes to the greater good of the company. Cause I think you're right, especially in a big company too. Sometimes like you feel like kind of lost in the mix. But yeah, it sounds like if executive leadership does a great job of like communicating the value of like an SDR, even if it is your first role, like I think it's valuable because that's sometimes, you know, the ICs lose track of like their impact really, you know, so that's a helpful reminder.
Yeah, definitely.
Well, thank you, Lily. This has been a really valuable conversation. Best of luck. I definitely see a need for it as telemedicine. And obviously like in the world of COVID, this is needed more than ever, right? Just like not only from a safety, but it's innovative and it's just more efficient as well. So really appreciate like the awesome work that you're doing to, you know, help make the world a safer, better place. And I'm excited to see what you continue to create in your career. And if anyone is interested in reaching out to Lily, I'll connect you to her LinkedIn and you can send a request just saying like, hey, you know, these are my takeaways from your conversation on the podcast. And yeah, thank you for sharing your time and your wisdom, and thanks for everything.
Yeah, thanks so much for having me. Hope you have a good day.
You too.
Bye.